Hello, Bob. I would need your technical advice. When I engage the tremolo, my amplifier, my guitar's volume goes up and down. How can I fix this problem?
Thank you for your email, Alfred. It sounds like the tremolo of your amplifier is working fine. Actually, it's just intended to automatically shift your guitar signal volume up and down. Okay, the email is a joke, but I promise I'll be more serious from now on. We are about to explore the world of tremolo effect from a historical, technical, and cultural point of view. From gorgeous tube tremolo of the 1950s and 60s to some great modern pedals that draw directly their inspiration from vintage amplifiers. Everything you need to know on classic tremolo. With only one or two control knobs, the tremolo may appear a basic effect. Yet, this matter is more complicated than you may think. It often involves a fair share of confusion. Tremolo types have been categorized in multiple ways depending on technology, sound, and so on. Also, tremolo has been widely confused with its close relative, vibrato. In fact, Fender and many other manufacturers have randomly labeled tremolo and vibrato effects in their official nomenclature. Basically, these two wonderful Italian words, tremolo and vibrato, have been used interchangeably for years regardless of their proper definition. To be exact, vibrato consists in an alternate shift in the pitch of a note, much like string pivoting technique, or a whammy bar, which in fact is properly defined vibrato arm, not tremolo. On the other hand, tremolo is a rhythmic, musical fluctuation in the amplitude of a note, which is its loudness or volume, like rolling a volume knob back and forth. For both tremolo and vibrato, the amount of fluctuation is typically labeled intensity or depth, and the frequency or tempo of the shift is named rate or speed. Which came first? The chicken or the egg? Have instruments been inspiring musicians, or have musicians been inspiring manufacturers? The original inspiration for the guitar tremolo might have come from church organs, or maybe early electric guitarists got basic tremolo effects with volume knobs. On the contrary, often the genius of designers precedes musicians' needs and inspires new sounds. Harry DeArmond, as early as in 1946, created the tremolo control, produced by Rowe Industries in Toledo, Ohio. It's considered the first commercial standalone guitar effect box. This rudimental but fascinating unit consisted in a tricky electromechanical device. The guitar signal was routed through electrolytic liquid, which was shaken by a motor. The movement of the fluid caused a variation in the electrical conductivity and consequently a modulation in volume. Whoa, baby, can we make it right? That's how Big Bear Bronze, backing the pianist Roosevelt Sykes, recorded the earliest known examples of guitar tremolo. Years later, plugging his guitar into the DeArmond tremolo control, Bo Diddley developed his trademark jungle rock sound. Diddley is probably the first notable guitar player to have used the prominent tremolo effect, inspiring entire generations of musicians. The tremolo control was also used in some groundbreaking recordings by Muddy Waters. And in the famous hit by Duane Eddy, Rebel Rouser from 1958. The Diarmond unit was closely followed by the first amplifiers to incorporate tremolo as a built-in feature. Nathan Nat Daniel, founder of the Danelectro company, was the first to design a tremolo system for amplifiers. He filed a patent application in 1947. Daniel was beaten to the punch. Premier released in that same year the Model 66, the first amp with built-in tremolo to hit the market. The ad said, "Tremolo lends new organ-like quality to your tone." Gibson followed close behind with the GA50T, released in 1948. The first Fender amplifiers with built-in tremolo, the Tremolax, arrived only years later, in 1955. Magnatone also joined the club in that same year, introducing the Model 113 Troubadour Deluxe. Typically, the tremolo on amplifiers of the 1940s and 50s was achieved by modulating the bias or grid current flow of the power tubes, by gradually decreasing and increasing back up the voltage of the tubes, the signal is alternatingly dropped and resumed. This method, named bias modulating tremolo, usually produces a luscious tune. The signal does not pass through a separate dedicated tremolo circuit, to the benefit of presence and fidelity. On the other hand, bias modulating tremolo can be hard on power tubes, especially in amps with fixed bias. In fact, it should never be used with a cranked up volume. A correct bias setting is also crucial to avoid excessive stress on the power section, which is a possible cause of failures. In mid-1957, Magnatone launched the 280 model, equipped with a revolutionary frequency modulation, or FM vibrato, which played a key role in the advertising campaign for the amplifier. This sophisticated circuit was patented by the talented engineer Don Bonham. It consisted in a complex combination of tubes and one or more pairs of a component device named varistor. The circuit was costly to produce, which accounts to the high price of Magnatone amps of the day. Surprisingly, the word vibrato was for once used in a proper sense of the term. In fact, Bonham's invention probably drew inspiration from rotating Leslie speakers and produced real pitch-shifting vibrato. The principle behind FM vibrato is shifting back and forth the phase angle of the audio signal to create some sorts of Doppler effect of frequency shifting. Leo Fender could not stand idly by and designed a circuit based on a similar phase shift principle that he named harmonic tremolo. This circuit involved the use of two or three preamp tubes and was adopted on the high-end models of the brown phase era of the early 1960s: Vibrasonic, Concert, Pro-Amp, Super-Amp, Bandmaster, Twin, and Showman. The old bias modulating tremolo remained on the more affordable models: Vibroverb, Vibrolux, Tremolux, and Deluxe. In essence, in the harmonic tremolo, a high-low pass filter stage splits the signal into high and low frequency components. These two components are modulated separately so that when the high frequencies are at peak amplitude, the low frequencies are at minimum level and vice versa. The interplay between these two equal tremolo waves out of phase with each other creates phase-cancelling effects, which give the listener a subtle perception of pitch shift. In 1963, Fender wanted, for the new Blackface amp line, a tremolo system that would be less costly to produce than the multi-tube harmonic tremolo, and technically more reliable than the power tube bias modulating tremolo. They adopted a system known as photocell tremolo. In this circuit, a low-frequency oscillator, or LFO, flashes a light bulb on and off at the set speed. A light-dependent resistor, or LDR, transduces variations in brightness of the bulb in variations in resistance of the input audio signal, creating the tremolo effect. Earlier bias-modulating and phase-shifting circuits produce a signal with sinusoidal wave pattern, perceived as a smooth pulsation. Photocell tremolo forms a triangle waveform, generally perceived as a choppier sound. The main issue is that this circuit sucks some signal off, even when the foot switch is disengaged. With the evolution of transistor technology, standalone effects began to spread as practical tools. A classic from the 60s is the Vox Repeat Percussion V809, either available as built-in effect in a line of guitars or standalone box that you could plug directly into the guitar. This effect produced sawtooth wave signal, which translates in a wild, choppy sound, reaching a totally on-off pattern at extreme settings. Examples of great use of repeat percussion include the electric prunes of I Had Too Much to Dream Last Night from 1966. Last night your shadow fell upon my lonely room. And the hypnotic double live album of the Spaceman 3, Dream Weapon, from 1990, described by the band as contemporary sitar music. In the early 80s, the built-in tremolo on amplifiers became old-fashioned. Guitarists had begun to favor stomp boxes, tending to more sophisticated modulation effects, such as chorus or flanger. In 1990, I had a Fender Red Knob amp without tremolo. I was listening to the Cramps and I thought, how cool is that sound? I want a tremolo in my setup. I had some money saved from a little job, so I just jumped on my bicycle and went to the store. I bought a Boss PN2, a nice tremolo pedal with a funny stereo panning function. The PN2 also had a nice square waveform option, reminiscent of repeat percussion tremolo type. About 12 years later, boutique pedals became popular. My old Boss PN2 had become relatively rare and valuable, so I decided to sell it to fund a higher quality tremolo stomp box. My choice fell onto great photocell pedals that I'm still using, the versatile full-tone Supertram and the Demeter Tremulator. Today, some interesting pedals aim to offer the superb tremolo effects of vintage amplifiers to present-day players. The idea is to bring, in our convenient pedal board, a faithful rendition of the sounds of valuable, bulky and delicate gear of the past, without the well-known drawbacks. The dynamic and resourceful Surfy Industries from Sweden released the amazing Surfy Vibe, a modern take on the Don Bonham circuit found in the Magnetone 280. Of course, tubes and varistors give way to a contemporary JFET and diode technology. The pedal also features a sweeping mode for a more pronounced phasing effect. The surfy vibe adds such an exciting touch that you need to find a free spot in your pedal board. The design philosophy of Surfy Industries does not support true bypass switching. Their pedals rather tend to mimic the color that the original circuits added to the dry signal. Surfy Industries is also producing a perfect companion piece, the Surfy Tram. The stomp box allows you to select between two different Fender tremolo styles. The brown face switch position emulates the harmonic tremolo of the early 60s. The black face setting is reminiscent of a photocell tremolo. Please find the Surfy Industries link in the description. Subdecay from Portland produces another brilliant Fender-inspired pedal on the same track. The Vagabond is entirely dedicated to the brown face era. Its all-analog circuit lets you choose between convincing emulations of the harmonic tremolo found in the top-shelf amps, like the Showman, and the bias-modulating tremolo on cheaper models, like the 6G11 Vibrolux. Thanks to this day's technology, Subdecay goes farther. The modulation range for both speed and intensity controls is way extended compared to the original tube circuits. If you crank up the intensity in bias mode, you get throbbing near square wave tremolo. The envelope speed control adds inspiring effects of acceleration and deceleration, responsive to playing dynamics. The regular drops in level of a tremolo give the listener a perception of volume loss, even if the signal technically matches unity level. The Vagabond features a volume boost in compensation. Subdecay products are distributed in Italy by Guitar Soz in Lecco. Please find the link in the description, which you could refer to for online direct purchase. Guitar Soz is also an excellent reference for buying, trading or selling vintage guitar gear. Guitar Soz also proposes the fourth pedal I have here, the Revival Tram, renamed the Lux 61 in 2022. It's made in England by Origin Effects. If you are after an all-in-one pedal solution, this may just be what you need. In fact, the Deluxe 61, taking inspiration from the Fender Deluxe Amp 6G3, combines bias modulating tremolo with a sweet versatile overdrive. At this point, a big question maybe is still looking for a clear answer. Why on earth should a guitar player desire an effect that deliberately drops down intermittently the volume of his guitar? Since the 50s, the tremolo proved to be a mellow, rich effect. It gives the sound a nice flickering feel that adds depth to the sound, dynamics to the performance, and personality to the arrangement. Often the tremolo is only a refinement. Sometimes it plays a major role, becoming the core of the arrangement itself. In songs like "On Cloudy Day" by the Staple Singers from 1956 and Nancy Sinatra's "Bang Bang" from 1966, featuring the Californian session man Billy Strange on guitar, the tremolo is so dramatic and powerful that it even makes up for an entire band. Now that I have your attention, here's a personal list of what I'm considering the seven wonders of the tremolo world. Seven iconic tremolo songs you cannot miss. Tito e Tarantula, After Dark, 1996. The Smiths, How Soon Is Now, 1984. Slim Harpo, Baby Scratch My Back, 1965. The Rolling Stones, Gimme Shelter, 1969. Bo Diddley, Bo Diddley, 1955. Nick Rae, Rumble, 1958. Creedence Clearwater Revival, Born on the Bayou, 1969. Bottom line, the tremolo might not be easy to combine with speed soloing or pronounced distortion, yet when used wisely, it leaves a distinct mark with a pleasant vintage feel. After nearly 80 years from its introduction, the tremolo remains one of the most attractive and evocative effects that you could have in your arsenal. Just choose your weapon. Please be sure to subscribe now and click the bell to check out what's next. Come to visit the Facebook group Bob Stone Review and follow our Instagram profile. Your comments and feedback are for me the only reason to keep the BTR channel going.